So welcome back, you guys, to another episode of Brotherhood TV, only here on BrotherhoodTV.com. Today's episode is a very special and a very unique episode, because today we're going to talk about sex, relationships, monogamy, and dating. That's a lot to talk about, so we'll start off there. So first we want to talk about dating, what the rules are of dating. What do you guys think of the rules of dating?
The rules of dating, well, I think everybody has their own set of rules for dating. You know, you make your relationship how you want it, not how society or how other people tell you to make your relationship. And, you know, so the rules of dating is there are no rules, or there might be some rules. Like, for example, if you're dating one person, you stick to that one person. If you want to date more than one person, okay, you got to let both of each other know that. But the thing, the one rule that I know everybody uses, if you don't even use rules, is communication.
Definitely,
communication
definitely.
Is a big thing with
dating. Definitely.
I think it's really interesting. I think that there's a lot of, I think it's really cloudy, I think, within the gay community, because I feel like we're so influenced by the heterosexual community and like how we see and how we date. I mean, like, you know, in the heterosexual community, you know, the guy has to act up the girl, you know, the guy pays. But I think when you're talking about two men, I think it gets a little bit, little hazy, little confusing. And so I think that there is no rule. I think sometimes we just kind of make it up as we go.
Right.
But
yeah.
I definitely think sex is involved.
You set your own pedestal, like you set your own like bar, you know, for what you expect out of somebody when you're dating them. Like we all have our own different expectations, and that may vary from person to person. Yours isn't the same as mine. Mine isn't the same as yours, et cetera, et cetera.
I definitely have to agree. I feel as if there should be rules. And when I say rules, I'm talking along the lines of that we should have a very strict understanding of what this is going to be. Because I can't walk into this relationship believing that, okay, we're going to be in a monogamous relationship. And you're thinking, oh, well, you know, we're just dating and I'm going to sleep with such and such. You know, so I definitely believe that it's very important that we have an understanding and definitely a foundation, having a pedestal, having something in how we define a relationship. Going back to the idea of being relationship and how we are so influenced by the heterosexual community as a whole, I feel as if in dating another man, whoever asks a person on a date should pay for the date. What do you guys think?
Yeah.
Yes.
I totally agree with you. That's common courtesy. Why ask me out
yes.
if you don't have any money?
That's true. That's so true. But what if you guys, you know, we continue dating, you know me, and they actually continue dating. For me, it's 50-50. A relationship is 50-50. It's never 75-25. It is, I will pay for dinner one after. If I ask you out, I'll pay for that, okay? And if we continue dating, you like me, we're starting to really get into a relationship, it's 50-50. I'll pay for movies, you pay for dinner, vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
We take turns.
I kind of disagree with the person asked. I mean, I get it. I think that, you know, it doesn't have to be this way. But I feel like, for me, my first date has to be Dutch. Like, you know, because I feel like, you know, when someone pays for it, I feel like there's certain expectations that come with it.
People
get used to it. I mean, whatever, you know. So it's like, I feel like, for me, I just think it's a lot easier. I mean, so if it didn't happen, it's not something that you can, like, at the end of the day, like, you know, hold on my head that you paid for the dinner. I mean, like, people can be so, like, so superficial.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I do a rule. If you're meeting somebody, like say you meet somebody on the internet, what have you, and then like you guys initiate a date and I ask you. My way of letting you know once upon that meeting and we meet each other, I'm not gonna let you pay for me if I don't like you. So I'll pay for my own stuff.
I like that rule.
When you're like going on this first date with this person, how do you say it without coming off rude? Like, you know, you're paying for your own plate.
You give them the check after you put your card in.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
You just say you're Dutch.
Because, like I say, you said, I mean, people do generally jump the gun to that. You ask me out, oh, that means you're paying for it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, sometimes it can come off rude if you're like, I pay for my part, now you pay for yours.
But then I don't think people really mind. Like, if I ask you out, and I'm obviously not going to mind that I pay. But you also gotta make sure before when you ask that person asks you out, you got to be like, okay, I accept your offer, but I just wanna clarify, just so I know, are we going Dutch or Are you paying or am I paying? What's going on?
So
there
should
definitely
be a certain sense of clarity. For me personally, I feel as if I'm going to ask you on a date, I'm going to pay for the date. I agree, like, in a relationship, we're going to split, we're going to go half and half, or I paid this time, you paid that time. For me personally, I know what I want. So I tend to more like to ask guys out only because I just know what I want.
Yeah.
So it's just like I prefer to pursue what exactly it is that I want.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I'm gonna be honest, like when I'm not a super person, I am uncomfortable a little bit with the guy paying for me. Because I feel as if like there's a certain sense of asserting control there that makes me uncomfortable.
Really? I wanted to ask a question about the rules thing. Now when you set rules, are they just like, is it like preliminary rules and then it's like the big bang rules? Or is it just like you just okay, I have about three rules. If you break these rules, these are the consequences. And are your consequences all or nothing? Like, okay, well, you cheated on me, so I'm done. Or I saw you looking at that boy, I'm done.
No.
Like, how does that work? Because it's no point to set a rule if there's no repercussion.
But if you're cheating, we're done. That's end of discussion. Like, you had the chance to take and cheat on me, we're done. I don't, you know... If we're dating, okay.
Easier said than
but
done.
If we're in a relationship,
it's very
easier said
than done.
Said than done.
So
you
don't
that
do it.
So
it's
there's no purpose
different.
To implement a rule that you initially will not follow. Like, say if that person, like, okay, you can't cheat on me. If you cheat on me, we're done. Like you're saying right now, because you say it right now until you fall in love with somebody, and then you fall in love, and it's like, oh, you cheated on me. All right, well, this one,
no.
I'll just sweep this under the
no.
rug. But
not like that.
Not
like
no.
that.
I'm sorry, my heart is too much. My heart is worthy of too much. And for you to cheat, no, not at all.
You so you are very like, if you do it, you're done.
Yeah.
But you were just saying it's easier said than
it's
done.
It's easier said than
so
done.
So you wouldn't break up with him right away.
I think that's a rule I would like to imply, but I gotta be real.
So what makes you not want to leave them alone? This is for y'all too. What makes you not want
to
leave them alone?
Let me first to answer your question, then we can go into that.
Okay.
We walk into a relationship, I personally feel as if like, we need to set what the ground rules are for this relationship. And periodically, we need to revisit those ground rules. We need to revisit those ground rules and find out where exactly are our hearts? Where exactly are we emotionally? Where exactly are we mentally? And accordingly, go with those new rules if we are asserting new rules. Personally, if a guy cheats on me, I want out. But it's very hard. Like Angel said, it is very hard, especially when you've invested so much into
exactly.
that person. You know, so I personally feel as if a lot of times I think about people who are in abusive relationships, people who are in both emotionally and physically abusive relationships, where they love that person so much. They force themselves to believe that this person needs me. You know,
this person will change.
This person will change. You know, so it's hard. But I personally believe this goes back to knowing your self-worth. This
right.
goes back to knowing who you are. It is hard. And that comes from experience. It is hard.
So I just want to also comment on that question. I feel like Dr. Phil says, you teach people how you want to be treated. You have to teach them, because they're not going to know otherwise. And silence equals consent. I believe that wholeheartedly. I feel like there are certain things in relationships that are turn-ons, certain things that are turn-offs, and there are certain things that are deal-breakers. That, for me, I'm just going to give you an example of deal-breaker. If you put your hands on me, for any reason, it's a deal breaker.
Other than sex, though, you can put your
right.
hands on
exactly.
Oh yeah, you can.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I can go forward with that.
Right? Hey, so
that's a deal breaker. Violent. That's the
right.
context. Violent.
To insert me. Never mind.
So we'll be right back, you guys. So we were just talking about monogamy and monogamy in the gay community. Why is monogamy just not there?
I think because a lot of gay people are so prone. You go to the club, you can find sex. You go on the internet, you can find sex. Even in the straight, you know, straight world is the same thing, but it's more easy and it's more accessible. Yeah, they have sex everywhere. I think we're just more, what is it? I can't explain. Like, we're just more...
Stereotype?
No, we're more prone to have just random sex. It's just hit, like...
I don't know, I disagree. I feel like it's a, definitely a social norm where people just believe we are. Because for me personally, if I'm going to get into a relationship with you, I want to be in a relationship with you. This goes back to talking about rules. This goes back to talking about that contract at the beginning of a relationship. So I definitely feel as if monogamy is a possibility, but
yeah.
this goes back to, I personally believe, you know, in this conversation we've had, that gay people just don't know how to date.
Let's not categorize every gay people. Some gay people know how to date.
A few of us know how to date, but it's put out there as majority. What I said earlier about
the fact that we really don't have, you know, a manual. I mean, there's no one that we learn everything we learn from relationships from the heterosexual world.
Mm-hmm.
And when we are dating other men, we find out real quick that it's all kinds of different exceptions. It's a very unique situation. And I think that's probably the biggest disconnect dating and being in relationships for us.
And I would say, like, don't expect the unexpected. Like, you never know what's going to come forth with it. And we definitely miss that whole chapter of dating. Like, when we meet someone, it's usually like, you know, let's hang out, or it's like that initial meeting is in your home or in their home, and then that can lead, you know, to the sexual process of it. And a lot of the times, like, people stigmatize us as, like, you know, we just hook up and, like, we're running around, we're carrying, like, HIV and, like, different STDs, because all we do is sleep with countless men, but that's not the case. There are those out there that, you know, actually do want to date.
Me too.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
They actually do want to date and actually, like, you know, meet somebody and have that connection with them, and you know, we lack it.
Quick question. So the idea that all men cheat, what do you guys think?
That's a lie.
That's a lie. I don't cheat.
Everyone cheats.
I can honestly say I have never cheated.
Simpkins.Ernest@BrotherTV.com.
I have never cheated either. Never will. I don't have the heart to.
Adam.
You tried it. You got one more time.
I think what it is, you know, the nightlife and the whole era for gay people in general, we are always out. There's always something going on. We are always celebrating something of some sort.
Mm-hmm.
And with that goes, like, there's many options. Like, you go somewhere, you may see, like, you know, somebody that you like here. You go there, you see somebody you like there. That doesn't mean that you need it, though. And a lot of people just there, they want to have their cake and eat it, too.
Exactly.
Is thinking about cheating considered cheating? To some people, it is.
No.
It depends.
Because
even though the Bible says you think it, you've done it. But
ooh.
I don't believe that.
What about, it's like, obvious we're men and whatever. So obviously, we see somebody at the party, somebody at the club, oh, he's hot. But it's like, you're in a relationship, you're like, I'm not even going to try anything. But you thought about it. Like, this person is attractive. I would have loved to do something with this person, but I'm in a committed relationship.
I would definitely.
Did you cheat for thinking about it?
I believe you didn't cheat for thinking about it. Something that people don't understand is that we are all sexual beings, and we have to understand that we all see someone and are attracted to that person. But when it comes to relationship, what it comes back to is that respect. For me, before love comes respect. Before commitment comes respect. Before all those things, it comes respect. And I have to, you know, you have to respect me if this is gonna work. You know, we have to be, you know, above anything. I just believe that it's about respect.
Yes.
So when it comes to respect, do you believe, like, I know we were talking about it earlier, like, we do have lives before we get into our relationships, but once we get into those relationships, we have to accommodate, you know, things that we're going to do different.
I agree.
So I love going to the club.
I agree.
Don't get me wrong. But it's like, going to the club, you realize what you're really doing. Like, if your boyfriend was there just watching what you do at the club, it's like, that's what the respect is. I mean, your booty is all up somewhere, and, you know, your boyfriend won't appreciate it.
Somebody said that if you have to hide, you probably shouldn't be doing it in the first place.
You should.
Like, if you wouldn't do that in front of your boyfriend.
Right.
That,
you shouldn't be doing it. Shouldn't be doing it.
That's how you know you should be doing it.
All right, so thank you guys so much for joining us, and we'll be right back. All right, well, welcome back, you guys. So back to what I was saying about love and lust. We need to find out what the difference is between love and lust. Because we can lust at a person, want this person so much, they're so sexy, and you want to bang them out, get banged out, or whatever it is. You know, we have to be able to decipher between what love and lust is. So back to the question of when I feel that it's appropriate to move in with a boyfriend and say I love you to a boyfriend, it's all in the lines of how comfortable we are and knowing that even if this person, God forbid, tomorrow got in a car accident and couldn't walk, am I still gonna stay around? If this person can't perform from the waist down, do I love that person? Do I really love that person? So there's a big difference between love and lust, and we have to be able to decipher the difference between those things.
Well, love for me is, you know, 6 months still feeling that same feeling when I first saw a person. Butterflies. You know, that person's, even though, you know, we have bad stuff, like we fought, we're still together. We're not letting the little stuff break us down. They're not like the cover on the toothpaste is not breaking us up. We're not fighting. We're not arguing so much that we're communicating better.
Yeah.
But if you have those butterflies and you have that feeling like, wow, this person really makes me smile. This person has given me everything, has never thrown a thing in my face.
Mm-hmm.
For me, that's love.
There's definitely a big difference between also dating and being in a relationship. Dash touched on it. I personally believe when in being in a relationship with a person, me personally, I want to see your credit score. I want to know what I'm getting into. Exactly what it is. Being from a person that comes from a financial background, of where I work and all those things, it's very important that they want to hire you if you have bad credit, because then that leads to you possibly stealing, that leads to you possibly an array of things. You know, I want to know what I'm going to be getting myself into in dating you, and I want to know your credit.
Okay. But you need to know the credit. I feel like you need to know the credit if you're going to move in with that person.
Yeah.
That's a very serious commitment.
Yeah.
Hold on.
Let me also add, if I feel that this is something that could possibly be long-term.
Okay. We're in a long-term relationship, okay? We're moving in. You can see my bank statements. There's money in the bank. My bills are paid on time. My car is paid. Okay, if I'm showing you my bills are paid, and I'm not over here asking you for money or asking other people for money, and I'm letting you know everything is good, you don't see my credit score. Because what if I have a bad credit score because of certain circumstances?
Right.
Okay, that's not for you to know. That's some personal information that I want to keep, and I don't want to let you know because I don't want to feel embarrassed. I don't want to feel embarrassed.
Why?
That
Why should
if
I
have
embarrassed
a bad
in a relationship?
We're already together.
Because
we're already together. Why do we need to feel embarrassed for?
But
that's
see, that's the thing.
We should be able to tell that person the way
anything.
They like.
Yeah.
And they should be able to understand.
There's
not
a difference.
Judge you, on
if
it.
You have a bad credit score because of your parents. If you have a bad credit score because you have a bad spending habit, you have a bad credit score because you're irresponsible with money, that can have an effect with us.
Yes.
And as a person, I personally believe that money management is very, very important.
Yes, it is.
You can't manage your money, how the hell are you gonna manage a relationship with me?
Yes.
So
I agree. But you will see my you can see my bank statements.
Maybe they need help. But then
right,
I mean,
yeah.
The other side to that too is that I could achieve so many great things, have my PhD, and still be an amateur at love.
True.
So it goes both ways.
True.
I don't think it necessarily has to be related.
That's definitely
true. I just feel like the whole moving in process, like I get the whole relationship thing, we're in love. But when you move in with somebody, you have no time to yourself. Your home is your personal time. You get to come home, you get to do whatever you need to do to clear your mind. When somebody moves in with you, that is like a whole breath. That's a whole different take on things.
Mm-hmm.
Like we are together, like you live here, I live here, like, you know, and hopefully you are gonna do the right thing, like with us being together. So I just feel like you said, knowing the financials, not to say like if somebody had a bad credit score, not everybody's credit is perfect. But that's something where you can take it and be like, okay, well, I'm going to motivate you to move this to the next level so we
exactly.
can make advancements in life. We can buy a house together. We can own our car together. We can start a business together.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're lacking, I don't know that, and then when it comes time for us to do all these great things and these great ideas, and it doesn't work out, then it's like, well, I don't know, it'll turn me off.
I feel like also then you need to know the real reason behind it, why you're moving in.
Mm-hmm.
Some people's like because they just can't get enough of each other. They just want to spend every second minute of the day together.
Mm-hmm.
But then they realize that didn't work or that takes effect on them. You need to know the real reason why you're moving in, because you still got these butterflies and you feel like a year from now it's still gonna be going, or because you feel like this is somebody I can build the future with. This is somebody
exactly.
I see me with for years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some people just they need to really know what they're doing before they jump to it.
I totally agree with you. But I also think that I like the time to miss somebody. Okay.
Right.
Yes.
I love
yes.
the time that we get to miss that person. Like, okay, we don't need to go on vacation. We can go on vacation together. We don't need to do every single thing together. We had a life before each other.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have a life after each other
mm-hmm.
if we break up. So I don't like that we have to spend every single minute of the time together.
Mm-hmm.
I need my own space. I need to do my things. The gym,
so,
listening to music, driving, or just me time. We have you time. So I need that time to miss you, even if we do live together.
Yeah.
I have a question. Does anybody else have any So we all have like that friend who has like 30 million ex-boyfriends.
Yes.
And
because I feel like it's chill to date everybody.
Right.
But, yeah.
And it's just it gets like
got three.
Right. Like
got three.
Then do you have to look at that and say, is that did you love all those people or was it less? Were you just like with that person because it was convenient and it was available for you?
That's just like today I only dated two people. And I feel like everybody's like, oh, only two people? I'm like, yeah. I mean, I might have talked to other people, been sexually active with other people, but really dated, really been in a relationship with two people. Because I don't just make anybody my boyfriend.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, oh, you're cute, I'm cute, let's date.
Right.
No, in order for you to get that title of being my man, it needs to be something there. There's something to build on. That's something that 3 months from now is done.
You need to be breaking down some walls, going through some obstacles with me. You need to be
you
here
need
when
to
I'm
really
going through something.
Right.
To get that title as a boyfriend.
And a lot of
and I think that's where the lack of wisdom comes in.
Right.
And where you just wear your heart on your sleeve and you don't have wisdom, that's a really horrible combination. I also feel like when you are in, when you're doing that, I feel like that's really one of the big reasons why HIV rates are so high in our community, because once you say that we're in a relationship, I'm not saying all the time, but it's very likely that you're not gonna use protection. Because you're in a relationship. Why are you going to use a condom if you're in a relationship? And I know so many people that the person in my, that comes to my head that have gone through 30 boyfriends, they don't use protection. Once you're in a relationship,
And there, like, and what I feel there's a lot of in the homosexual community, like, you know, just gay, lesbians, whatever, is a lot of us are codependent. Instead of being independent.
Yes.
So, like, you're depending on having somebody to fill that void. And you really have to take the time after those relationships. Like, a lot of people date and then get into a relationship, break up, then start dating again. And it's like, yeah, I get it. Date, have fun. But still take that time to really work on yourself and better yourself.
That's when you keep jumping
right,
through all the boyfriends. Because it's like,
you
break up, and then a week later, you're dating somebody else, you're in love.
Mm-hmm.
A couple months, then you're single again. And then it's like you don't give yourself time to breathe and realize, okay, it's time for myself. And then try to like first find yourself, first know yourself. First, like if you broke up with this other person, you broke up with them for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
And then you jump the gun and you're madly in love again.
Yeah.
It's like, I think it's just it comes to the person, just can't be alone.
Right. You need to love yourself before you can love anybody else.
Right.
And it also goes back to what you said. You need to be able to be by yourself. Because the being by yourself is the best time you can have.
Some people just can't be alone. They need that person.
That idea of codependency, though, is something that we really have to touch on. It's because, first of all, I feel as if in our community, especially in communities of color, we don't have examples of affirming gay, lesbian relationships in the public eye. We don't have that. We don't have that idea. So we feel as if being alone a lot of times, we feel like we need someone else to define us. We need someone else that's gonna complete us. No one else can complete us. We have to complete ourselves. And this goes back to knowing your self-worth as a person and knowing what it is that you bring to the table. I have to define myself because I cannot be dependent on you. You know, when it comes to protection, again, I walk to everything with the idea that, you know what, he's not gonna protect me. I have to protect myself.
Yes.
You know, so that's something that's very important, and that's something that I stress, and I want to make sure that viewers understand. Like, we have to know our self-worth. We have to know what it is that we bring to the table. We have to define ourselves. Don't be dependent on anyone. Be dependent on yourself. So in closing that off,
I just want to say just one quick thing real quick. I think that when you're talking about relationship, you're talking about matters of the heart. And I think that your most prized possession that you can ever give anybody is your heart. And so the question at the end of the day you have to ask, is this person worthy of my heart?
I agree.
Some people just give out to anybody.
Is he worthy?
And if you need any special therapy sessions, Ernest's email will be right up on the website.
Yes.
<www.com>.
So thank you guys so much. We'll be right back to do our Dear Brother letters.
Hello, and we're back now with Brotherhood TV.
Yeah, I would like to start off with a dear letter. Okay, so every time I go to the club, other black guys hit on me. I am not at all attracted to black guys. I feel that they are full of drama, indecisiveness, and usually are stuck in the closet. I am not racist, it is just my preference. How do I let black guys down without sounding mean, racist, or rude? I'm not interested.
First of all, racist, he
I'm guessing
the
black
guys.
I'm guessing the black.
I need to say this real quick. So when I first started exploring my sexuality,
yeah,
I actually was not attracted to black guys at all. Now the reason, because there's always a story behind
yes,
why.
Yes, there's always a story.
So the reason is because all the black men that I had seen growing up were like, they were dogs, they were cheaters, they were liars, they were abusive. They just really completely, from that was the image, that was the only, at least, immediate representation I saw of black men. So I just wasn't attracted to them.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but I mean, as time went on, obviously you sort of mature and you sort of take those, knowing that all those they might have been that way, they don't represent the entire community. And so I think that for me personally, I probably have had like the strongest, most amazing connection with another black male. There's nothing like it.
I personally feel when I first came out, I was the same way. I was like, I don't know black men. I'm just, no. Because I feel like I grew up around nothing but black people. So I wanted something different. Like if I'm going to come out, I want to be like, I'm not saying like I want to be different and I want to be cool because I'm dating a white guy. I just like, it's not a normal thing. So it's like, I don't usually see white people around. So it's like, oh my God, I want to date a white person. I want to learn about them. I want to see how they are, how their family works and different things like that. So it was more like an experiment thing. But yeah, like you said, as I've gotten older, it's like, I really just really like, the way.
I can't. So I definitely feel as if it sounded to me as racist and judgmental when he said, the fill of indecisiveness and in the closet, because I'm none of the above.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know exactly what I want, and I'm in no one's closet. So, you know, I definitely feel as if that's where it verges on being rude. If he says it's my preference because I prefer other races or whatnot, you know, like, I tend to like Spanish guys a lot, you know, but I love black men. But I mean, so I definitely feel as if it's rude and it's just incorrect. But if that's going to be his preference, he should definitely state that you know, he's just not interested, but be polite about it and don't be rude about it.
Mm.
You know? Anyone have any other thoughts on this letter? So I'll go to the next letter. So Dear Brother TV, so I don't know if you accept letters from women, but I said, hey, I'd give it a try, and we do. I'm a 24-year-old woman. 24-year-old straight woman. My question is, my boyfriend of a year and a half has told me one of his fantasies is for me to strap up and penetrate him. It shocked me only because he doesn't come across as gay. He's a very masculine guy who plays sports, so I would never guess that he would want to do that. He showed me that he isn't gay, but nowadays you just never know. What do I do? Could he be gay?
Well, first of all, dear, don't be ignorant to society. I mean, don't be ignorant in general. Because in society, it's viewed that if, obviously we're gay, so that is our root of, you know, sexual intercourse. But if you do your research, you understand that the man's G-spot is actually in his anus. So him wanting to be penetrated doesn't mean necessarily he wants a man to penetrate him. He just wants to be penetrated. And, you know, he wants to indulge in that kind of ecstasy.
That is fine. I feel that, I don't think that he's so much gay. I feel like the tool that he was using, the fact that he said strap on, it's penis-like. Well, it is actually a plastic penis. So you want a penis in your anus. I don't personally get that. Maybe if it would have been something else, maybe a finger, maybe
a popsicle,
whatever's your twist. But just the fact that it is actually a plastic penis, it bothers me. It bothers me, so I think you should kind of check into it.
No, I don't think so.
I think so.
I definitely think
he
so.
He might really like it, and you just never
he just
know.
Wants her to strap up and get
so you
in
want me
him.
To be in the back of you, because I can sit on the side of you and do like that.
And
you want me to be in the
like,
back of you and round you up, and you want me to pound you
yes.
excessively. No.
That
how
does that make
him feel?
Yeah. You can do like this. You can do like this until you hit it. It's
no,
right here. Okay,
he wants the whole thing.
You
want a penis.
Let's not forget that there are men out there who prefer being topped by transgender women.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That is a
women.
Fantasy.
Yeah.
Are they homosexuals?
They're
yes.
not.
No.
It's
no.
a penis going in your butt.
Two men.
No, it's not.
Wait, hold on. A transgender woman. They like to be topped by transgender women.
Yeah. They have a penis. That's a man's.
No,
oh, you're pretty. You look like a woman. But I want that.
No.
I want
but
that
doesn't mean, yeah, but that does not mean that he will then want to go to another man.
Exactly.
And be penetrated.
He's
by
not
going
to go to the other man.
You're only homosexual if your connection is with
okay, so
a
transgender,
man.
Are you telling me, is a woman?
She is a woman.
No.
She is.
Yeah, she is.
You're a man.
She is physically. No. 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 Don't be ignorant. A transgendered. If a man transitions into a woman, he is
he's not fully transitioned. He still has this his breasts.
It doesn't, but they're in transition.
You're
like,
in transition
matter.
It is two different things. You need to be complete to be called a woman. You're not a woman just because if I put on clothes, put on titties, and I'm a woman.
But it doesn't
but
matter.
I have
a lot of transgender.
That's different.
If they get their ID switched to female, they are then.
So if I get my,
but you need to be.
It's how
you
identify.
Live your life.
It's how you identify, and it's your preference. It's a big difference between.
If I identify as a white woman, am I a white woman?
Yes or no?
You feel like you identify as that, baby, and
so
society
is my world.
Wants
you
to
it doesn't matter. I understand where you're going. Where you feel this strongly about yourself, but I feel like you're not done the transition until you have the vagina. You are still a man if you have the penis. You just dress up like a woman. You're transgender. You're not a woman.
Okay, we can do some transgender 101.
Go ahead.
Because there is, in fact, a difference between gender identity, whether I am identifying as a male or female, gender expression, which is I might identify as a male, but I like wearing a dress,
mm-hmm.
doesn't make me any less than a man,
mm-hmm.
and sexuality. Now, it could be very much the case that I have transitioned from female to male, but I identify as gay. It may also be the case that I have transitioned from female to male and I only like women. And that same argument, it's the same with transgender women. Many transgender women out there will identify as straight. Because why? They like men, they identify as a woman, and they like men. They're heterosexual. They're not gay, they're not lesbian, they are straight. That's how they identify. It's about how people identify.
Oh, that's what you're telling me. I'm not knocking anybody, so it's how I identify. So if I said that I am a white woman, you're going to tell me that I am a white woman.
That's how you self-identify. I will respect
that. I respect that.
I was a white woman. Do you know in your heart that I am not a white woman? I am nowhere near
by looking at you. By looking at you.
It doesn't matter what she thinks.
By we look at you.
That's why
you identify.
How I identify.
And if you put on a piece of paper, you identify that.
Okay, I can write it right here. I'm a white woman. Address me as such.
Okay, then that's how I will respect you.
When they send
you.
When they send you the sentence, they're not there with you.
It's not the truth.
Okay,
so what I think he is.
We're gonna have to pause for 1 second, and come right back.
But no, he's not gay.
We don't know.
We'll be right back.
Ask for her brother.
All right, so welcome back, you guys, to Brotherhood TV. So we left off talking about a letter that we received, and Ernest wanted to go in and say something.
So the previous discussion before we went,
yes.
on break, I think your issue is that I think you're stuck on this whole concept of passing. Mm-hmm. So if you asked me about if you identify as a white woman, I would respect you. I would respect that wholeheartedly. What I think you would probably pass in society as a white woman?
You
probably wouldn't. I'm sorry.
Personally, to me, I just feel like I'm not knocking anybody. I don't have the problem with transgenders or anything like that, but I feel like you are not it until it's fully completed.
Okay.
So you are a man. I don't care what you can pass for, because they can't pass for a woman if they walk down the street butt naked.
But hold on. For me, I identify as Hispanic. I look white. White as a ghost. But I am half Puerto Rican, half Italian. You can't tell that unless I tell you. So, for a person to tell you...
Wait, I don't care what you tell me. I don't care what I believe. You're not just Hispanic. At the end of the day, and that's what I'm getting at, I don't care what you tell the world. At the end of the day, you're not just Hispanic. You can tell me whatever you want to tell me. Like I can tell you, I'm a white woman.
I'm a dime knowing that I'm a white woman. I'm not a white woman at the end of the day. And that's all I'm trying to say is like, at the end, after all falls here, you can say whatever you want. You are still a man until.
I disagree.
So whatever I say, so basically this is what you're telling me.
It's how you, race, what you're putting on the table is, okay, I identify as a white woman. That's something completely
different
from saying how I identify, how I feel comfortable,
so,
how I feel inside is I am a woman. That's how I identify. I am a woman. I say, okay, I'm a woman. You are going to respect me as a woman.
I live my life as a woman.
I live my life as a woman, and I demand respect. I don't even ask for it. I'm demanding respect as a woman.
Yes, I will respect you. I will call you ma'am, miss. You're not a woman.
But at the end of the day, we have to take it back to this. Hermaphrodites, who are both born with both body parts, a vagina and a penis, then how do you identify them? You
hermaphrodites.
Right, but you can't sit down and say at the end of the day, you are a man.
No, at the end of the day, you are a hermaphrodite. You may dress up like a woman. You may look just like a woman. You're a hermaphrodite.
But there's only two things. There's a man and then there's
a woman. Yeah, I think, like I told y'all before, I'm very black and white, and I feel like if that's that, then that's that. This is this. This is this. This is this.
But this is not a black-white world. We don't live in a black-white world. We live in a world full of
diversity,
full of liberalism, full of who we identify ourselves as. Like, you know? And
yeah, that's why I wouldn't be rude and I wouldn't go up to a transgender and be like, I want you to know at the end of the day that you're a man. But I know in my head, that's what it is. At the end of the day, you're a man until you have your full transition.
But a lot of that money, it costs a lot of money to take your dick off.
No. Oh, that's fine.
All they do is shove it up. But it's a lot of money, so they can't. But they, inside, and in their mind, they feel like a woman. So they're going to live their life as a woman. They're going to dress like a woman. So they are a woman. All they want from you is the respect that they are a woman.
And I will respect them.
Okay.
In my mind.
But there are some men, at the end of the day, who like to be penetrated and that are not homosexual.
Oh,
so
just
have communicate. And then
it's just a penis form. That's the only thing that
comes with it. Alright, well, thank you guys so much for joining us here on Brotherhood TV. Only on BrotherhoodTV.com. Remember, we want your comments on all the letters. We want your comments that we talk about monogamy, dating, open relationships, the rules of dating, etc., etc., etc. So we've talked about a lot today, and we cannot wait to read your comments. And we'll be there to also add our comments. Again, BrotherhoodTV.com. You can catch every episode on a Monday. All right, so we'll see you guys next week. Bye-bye.